May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. So today, quite clearly in the Gospel reading, is a continuation of last week's Gospel reading. We have the vine and the branches, and you are me and I am in you. And we have 1 John, which is talking about the love, God that is love. And we are, in essence, just reading the next section of a set of dialogues between Jesus and his friends. And there are some really important parts in this that are worth our closer exploration. Obviously, based on the kids' story, I want to first look at the idea of joy and happiness. And there's this idea that small kids, and it's not just small kids, this is when you get older, you get better at hiding it. but the thing that they want is happiness. In the example today, cake for breakfast, and you would imagine when you're a small child that if I could just have all the cake in the world, I would be happy. However, if you've ever had, say, a chocolate binge, I'm not sure, you may be better disciplined than I am, but if you've ever had a chocolate binge, there are consequences for that. And that is called reality. And so little people think that the problem with happiness is too much reality. But as you get older, you learn that in fact, happiness comes out of reality, because it's the reality that you can't enjoy too much chocolate that allows you to enjoy just the right amount. And that's joy. And in fact, you can be like me, and you can be at work, and you can be thinking about the chocolate that's at home in the cupboard, and your mouth might be starting to water. And you're looking forward to that. You get all the joy out of it before you've even eaten it. And then you might have a piece of chocolate and it tastes good. And so joy and happiness. Because joy has length to it that happiness doesn't. There is something eternal in the nature of joy. People talk about eternal life, and for some, we start with the picture that eternal life is kind of life now, but without an expiration date. For Jesus, eternal life is a present reality, one where we are experiencing things that are eternal, and we are joyous about that. And so, that which is most eternal is the love of God and being immersed and embedded in it. So let us be joyous, for we know the love of God. Now, the other thing about joy is it's not incompatible with anything else. You can be joyous and sad. You can be joyous and happy. You can be joyous and grumpy. Probably a little trickier than that, because grumpiness tends to be inward looking. In fact, I want, I want, I want. I'm hard done by, but that kind of leads to grumpiness and anger. But joy is not incompatible with anything else. Joy is about the understanding and the experience of the presence of the love of God. The next section that I wanted to focus on is the conversation Jesus has with his friends. Now, we use the language Lord a lot in church. Lord Jesus, that sounds familiar to you, that's something you may have said. And because of time and our privileged circumstance in the world, we miss what that word means. The Lord of an estate was the one who was in charge, and everybody else was under them. And if you were a serf or a slave, your life was at their whim. Your very day-to-day existence depended on the goodwill of the law. And so for Jesus to have this conversation with his disciples where he says, you're no longer servants or slaves, you are now friends, means that they have been freed from that fear that would have imbued every slave. If a slave didn't do their work, they could be whipped, they could be executed, or they could be sold. You know, you can't do that to a friend. You can't just, you know, I'm pretty sure you can't on eBay sell a friend. If you are, they're not actually a friend. So let us have joy in the release that we have been granted, that we are not slaves. We are co-workers with Christ in the work of God. We are friends, not servants, not slaves, and will not be disposed of lightly. The third thing I wanted to focus on, I'm kind of feeling sort of semi-traditionally Anglican. The traditional Anglican sermon has 3 points, and I feel that this semi-traditionally Anglican. One of the very early arguments in the church, and you know what they say about Christians, get 2 or 3 together and they're going to have an argument. One of the earliest arguments was about the teachings of Jesus. And there were people who suggested that Jesus had secret teachings for his disciples. So he'd have a teaching for the masses. He'd have a different teaching for the inner circle. And if you had the teaching of the inner circle, then you were special. You were particularly chosen by God. In fact, the teaching of the inner circle might guarantee you entry into heaven. It was literally, if you can get your mind right, everything else is fine. And the biggest problem with that, as is the problem with many things, is Jesus. Because Jesus was abundantly clear that he taught everyone everything. There is no secret teaching. There is no hidden secret buried away in the catacombs in Rome. At least not of Jesus. So Jesus is talking to his friends. He says, everything the Father is taught me, I have taught you. And this is the final, this is what it boils down to. This is my command. Love each other. Love is caring for the other. Caring so much for them that their well-being is more important to you than your own. Having regard for them greater than your regard for yourself. And the kingdom of heaven would look like this. Everyone being able to follow that instruction. Take a moment to imagine the world where everyone follows that instruction freely, as friends of Christ, knowing great joy in what they do. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.